show yourself approved. Last week, I spent quite a bit of time covering something that we've covered quite often, because I want to make sure you get it. Part of the reason is because I hear what people are saying. If I heard somebody say, well, I'm going to paint my house, I need 3 gallons of paint, I only have one, so I'm going to put 2 gallons of water in to make sure I have 3 gallons, I'd be going, that's not going to work. Spiritually, when I know things that I know about God and what He said in His Word, what we ought to be doing and what we ought to be speaking, and I hear people speaking the way they're speaking, I have to address it. And until I see a major difference, I feel like I still need to point out some things. And I want to use these things, and these points need to be in the front of your mind as you're reading the scriptures. Number one, what do I have to do? What's my responsibility? I've heard people say, I'm here if God wants to use me, He can use me. That's like saying, I have a job, if my boss wants to use me, he can use me. Expecting your boss, it's like expecting your boss to come into your house, wake you up, take you by the hand, put you in the shower, brush your teeth, and then put you in the car, drive you to work, get out of work, grab the hammer, put it in your hand. The God's not going to do any of that. It's your responsibility to get up, do what you have to do, show up to work, do your job, then you get the reward. God is there to help us through this, but if you choose to say when the alarm rings, I'm not going to work today, He will not make you get up. So again, that's as far as I'm going with it this morning. Scripture says to be a doer of the word, not a hearer only. When you're a doer of the word is when you're plugged into the outlet and when power is available. The word of God says that the word is living and powerful. Jesus said, you got to eat my flesh and drink my blood. My word is meat. So the Bible tells us that man does not live on bread alone, but by every word. So this is just not ink on a paper. It is the word of God that sustains us spiritually. If you're spiritually weak, we had people pray and God will bless you, but it could be a result of your spiritual diet. Your physical diet usually shows up on your physical body. If you're eating too much, it shows up. If you're not eating enough, that will show up. And I don't know, too many people are not eating enough. Most people are eating too much or eating the wrong things. But if you do not feed yourself spiritually, you'll be malnourished. And unlike physical food, when you eat spiritual food, I don't know if I should use this example, but there's people who have a problem not wanting to gain weight, so they'll eat and then regurgitate so that they don't gain weight. Do you realize when you eat the Word of God and you're double-minded, and you read things about, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, and then you start thinking, oh no, what I'm going to do, it's like regurgitating the Word of God. It has no effect. It doesn't nourish you. You have to stay focused. So let's read the scripture. I had another scripture here in John 8:34. He said, if you know the truth, and you will keep my word, then the truth will set you free. 2 Timothy 2:15. Is the scripture we're using for this series. I'll give a minute to put up there. 2 Timothy 2:15, there it is. Up there it says, be diligent. One of the versions says, study to show yourself approved unto God. Let's just stop right there. The definition of the word study is the devotion of time and attention to gaining knowledge of a subject. So in order to study the Word of God properly, we have to give it time and we have to give it attention. In Proverbs 3, it tells my son, give attention, pay attention to my word. Bible tells us, for those who find it, it's life and health to their body. But he said, pay attention, give attention. If you're attending to something and it's important to you, and you give it a priority, if I'm doing something and if I have a priority, and someone says, can I talk to you? I'll say, not right now, I'm attending to something. And unfortunately, when it comes to the Word of God, it's the Word of God that gets put to the side many times. The next thing it says, be a good worker, one who does not need to be ashamed, and who correctly explains the Word of truth. Well, before I can explain something to somebody, I have to know it. One of the reasons why we study is so we can be a worker, not just to gain more knowledge. It's for a purpose. It's for a reason. I don't care where you're at. If you've been here more than twice, you've learned something that somebody else doesn't know that you can help. I don't care what step you're on. If I'm here, I can help somebody up to where I am. If I'm here, I can help somebody up to here. But the important thing is that we're studying and we're growing so we can help others grow. And we can't keep this truth to ourselves. We really can't. I don't want to get my leadership meeting mixed up with the sermon, but it applies. We're called to make disciples. Verse 16. Boy, we can go a long way with this one. Avoid worthless, foolish talk that only leads to more godless behavior. Verse 17, this kind of talk spreads like cancer, as in the case of the political arena we're facing today. I mean, you could put that there. This says Hymenaeus and Philetus, but just think about what this is saying. Avoid worthless and foolish talk that only leads to more godless behavior. I mean, we see this on the internet. The conversations people have, I look at what people think and what they say, and I'm just dumbfounded. You know, I wrote some, I backed way away from saying anything politically. The Bible says don't cast your pearls before swine. They're not ready to listen. Nobody wants to listen, so why bother? I'll hold my breath. But President Obama had said something. First of all, he was the president of the United States. It's a place of honor. You don't have to agree with what his policies were. He held a high place of honor in our country. He deserves respect for that, and he deserves prayer. So President Obama said something in one of his speeches that we don't need a savior or a messiah. And if you look, you know, communication's an awesome thing. Do you always say exactly what you mean? Has anything you ever said come out wrong? And somebody questioned you, oh, no, I didn't mean that. It was obvious by what he said that he was basically saying the economy's great because I did it. Okay, he said that. He said, basically he was saying, we didn't need this president to come along and fix it because it wasn't broke. So he said, we don't need a savior or a messiah, meaning we didn't need someone to come and fix it. That's all he was saying. So I posted it because so many Christians, oh, I can't believe he didn't said we didn't need a messiah. And they really made him say something he did, which is what people do to our president today. And basically I was saying, don't fall into the same trap. We're believers. We have a higher standard. And I had a Christian come back at me, assuming because I sounded like I was sticking up for Obama, that I was probably not on his side or whatever. And he's telling me, you need to wake up, brother. He's the Antichrist. And then, cursing, I'm like, okay, this is not, you know, I was just trying to say, let's all get along. Let's look into your, let's not forget the love walk. And he's telling me, I need to wake up, I don't know, and he's the Antichrist, and I'm going to hell. And I'm like, okay. I guess I can't even talk to people on my side anymore. You know, it's just, there's no conversation to be had. You know, I always looked at the issues, not the person. I didn't vote to pass through. There's issues. So that said, don't fall into the trap. Don't take the bait. Because what does it say? Avoid worthless, foolish talk that only leads to more godless behavior. We're seeing it lived out in our country right now. This kind of talk spreads like cancer. That's also happening. People who don't have an original thought, they hear something and go, oh, that's the way it is, and repeat it without ever looking into the facts. Verse 18. When you start talking about things and thinking about things that aren't godly, that aren't the word, that you don't take, I don't care what you believe, whether it's politics or anything else, and put it through the filter of the word of God, and you start considering and thinking of other things, maybe other religions, other gods, or you get into yoga and start getting into the spiritual end of yoga and start heading down these roads of philosophy that what was it, Nietzsche who said God is dead? You start studying some of this stuff, it puts you in a place where these guys got to in verse 18. They have left the path of truth, claiming that the resurrection of the dead has already occurred, and in this way they have turned some people away from the faith. First of all, to get to a place where we study and we have a firm foundation, the Bible says that in the end time, people are not going to give heed to sound doctrine. They're going to want itching ears. If you're not, there's no neutral in Christianity. If you're in the stream and you're not paddling and you just let go, you're going to go backwards. Especially in the current of the world we live in now. The Bible says in the end time, people are going to call good evil and evil good. We're seeing it lived out right before us. And if you just kind of go along listening to music that's on the radio, there is something to subliminal messaging. People say, well, I don't listen to the word. Yes, you are. Your spirit, I trust me, your spirit's hearing every word. Your spirit don't know the difference between a joke and it just hears things. Your spirit will be impressed when you start listening to the arguments and you send your kid to school and they're in college and they sit there day after day with these teachers explaining why women aren't really women, men aren't really men, and the only reason why women wear dresses is because we train them that way because they're kids. And I said, well, women are more nurturing. No, they're not. I was like, okay, conversation's over. I thought we were on a page we can agree. So we always have to be constantly aware of what's going in our ears and what we're listening to. Because they listened to something that caused them to get to a place where they had left the path of truth. There's teachings going out there, and again, we don't want to attack anybody teaching it. We don't even want to attack the message. We want to preach truth. But in the name of grace, there's a teaching going around, which is true, but it's half true. That God loves us no matter what. They totally eliminate consequences for our actions. The truth that God will love us no matter what doesn't mean that if you cheat on your wife, you might get divorced. There's consequences to our actions. God will still love you if you do it. There's consequences to your actions, and they leave that out. And if you do, I don't want to get ahead of myself, but if you do preach anything about living holy, or studying, or putting some effort in to get to know God and making time. Oh, it's works, brother. No, that's not works. One of the reasons why I shared last week and so many times about being a doer of the word and not a hearer only, so we can make sure we're doing it. So you could read the scriptures, and as we continue to read these scriptures in any scripture, every scripture I read points out to something I have to do to cooperate with that grace. And when I do, because he did all the work, then I can live victorious. Amen. I mean, if you just start out with, it says study to show yourself approved unto God. Well, what happens if I don't study? You as God could love you and not like what you're doing. He could love you and not be pleased with you. As a believer, I hope your desire is to please the one who gave all for you. That's what it comes down to. Am I pleasing you? Show me what's not pleasing you. Show me what I'm saying or doing that's not pleasing to you, and I'll correct it. Oh, you're going to love me no matter what, so I can keep doing this? That's not the answer. We had a teacher in school, he said, the answer to tight pants is not getting bigger pants. It's not the answer. Well, I'm not living right, but God loves me. Oh, so I can just keep doing more and just get more grace to fit around this big belly of sin. No, more grace is not the answer. If I'm having a problem, the Bible says where sin abounds, grace abounds all the more. That doesn't mean let me just keep sinning so God can keep throwing more grace on my sin and cover it. No, I get more grace to help me out of it. So I don't have to continue living in an ungodly lifestyle. The second part of this that's really alarming, many times when people leave the faith, have been deceived for whatever reason, many times the next verse says, in this way they have turned some people away from the faith with them. That's a scary thing. That's how church splits happen. Somebody said, did you hear? What? And then they tell them. And guess what that people do? What those people do? Did you hear what the pastor did? He did this, this, and this. No, I can't believe he did it. Instead of asking the pastor, Pastor, did you do this, this, and this? Yeah, I did, because of this, this, and this. Oh, now I understand. I would have done the same thing. But they don't do that. That's what the Bible says. Go to the person. But they hear something. They store it in as fact and belief. And then they tell it to somebody else. And the game of telephone starts. And by the fifth person who hears it, whatever that was done was really twisted and really bad. And everybody's saying, we got to leave this church. You have to bring everything into the filter of the Word of God. I remember when I first started going to church, this is why we have to be really diligent in making disciples. I'll share a little bit more of the leadership meeting. When I first started going to church, there is a real devil, by the way. He's the father of lies. Amen. His job is to sow a lie and reap an action. He's trying to get you to believe something that you're going to act on. If he sows a lie about a church, you'll leave the church. If he sows a lie about your husband or wife, you'll eventually leave your husband or wife. When I first started going to church, you're going to one of those born-again places? Like I had a disease. And it made me go, wait a minute, maybe I'm making a mistake. So if we don't tell people what the Bible says about being born again, when they hear that, will they back off? And I forget the stats, but people used to basically go to church every week. Now the average is 1.5 times a month. One time a month, basically, people feel, if I go to church once a month, that's my church, I'm good, I'm okay with God. I watch it on TV. I'll listen to the clip. The second thing I remember people hearing is, oh, they just want your money. They want 10%. I'll tell you what, when I first heard that the church wanted 10%, I was like, what? They don't do that. Well, we need to tell people. It's in the Bible. My friend went, that's a Pentecostal church. It's Spanish, right? That's how you say it in Spanish? No, I don't hear that. They're crazy. Now, listen, these things were all thrown at me. Every step of the way, making me question what I was doing. Probably the biggest thing that caused me to question was my own household. I came home and I didn't do the right thing, telling everybody they were wrong and I was right. You know, I was wrong. But when I saw my mother cry, we grew up Catholic, and when I was getting baptized, it upset her. I love my mom. I love my mom, and I would never want to hurt my mom. That was one that made me come real close to saying, I'm not going back there if my mother's going to cry. I almost stopped going. But the Word of God, if you don't know the truth, He said, if you continue my word, then you'll know the truth, and then the truth will set you free. Thank God I had enough sense. I went up, sat on my bed, started crying. God, I never want to hurt my mom. She don't deserve this. Guess what? The devil knows the word. Guess what scripture you're throwing at me? Anybody guess? Yeah, honor your mother and father. It's in the Bible, and we need to. So that almost solidified my decision. So I opened the word. And it says, if you love mother and father more than me, you're not worthy of me. And I realized I had to follow God. If nobody on earth liked it, I had to follow God because I had to follow Him. And then I was saying, but God, my mother's crying. And I was really young in the Lord. I've heard God's voice throughout the years, but this is, I want to say like I've never heard before, but it was just the first time, that's why it feels that way. But I heard something I had never heard before. I heard a voice said, I love you. I was like, it can't be God. It just can't be. I kept complaining. But God, my mother's crying, and I just kept going like I didn't hear anything. And I heard that voice the second time get a little bit more stern and said, I said, I love you. I said, that's really true. You know, you can have six conversations in your mind at the same time. It's amazing how playing baseball, when you've got like less than a half a second to make a decision to swing the bat, how many thoughts, keep your arms up, keep your hand ball. It's amazing. But so this is what's going through my mind. That can't be God. God doesn't speak to people like this. God, was that really you? But my mouth was still going, complaining. Oh, but God, you know. And then the third time, he yelled at me. I said, I love you. I knew it was God that time. And I just wept. And then he told me what I needed to do to reach my family. That I just needed to love them and live it before them. And that they would see the love of God and eventually I got cards from my mother. See, that was one thing growing up with a mom and dad that were always at everything you did, that was always proud of everything you did. All of a sudden, the first thing in my life I'm doing, she wasn't really proud of. But I eventually got a card from her and said, I'm proud of you, son. You're doing what God wants you to do. And then I would hear her talk to people when we'd meet somebody. That's my son. He's a pastor. Just stay the course. But again, without knowledge, I would have been destroyed. I'm going to go down the road where I had a friend who was telling me about aliens, you know, back then, if a helicopter came down, and, you know, I was like, wow, what happened to that? That one didn't last long. I walked away from him going, nah, that's stupid. But he had me thinking for a second, you know. Why am I saying that? We're living in a world that when I walked out of church back then, there was a couple of people, I had to run into them. Now, someone posts, hey, I just went to church. You've got 50 people attacking them, why there's hypocrites in church, and why this, and why that, and their experiences. They're bombarded with why they shouldn't be going to church, and what's wrong with the church, and they're bombarded. God forbid they Google Rhema. Do it sometimes. Nothing good's going to come up. But nothing came good when they, if you would have Googled Joshua and Caleb, nothing good would have come up. They wanted to kill them for saying, God said we can do it. Let's kill them. Basically, the Word of Faith movement basically says, with God, we can do all things. We have more than enough. If he called us to start a church, we have more than enough money. He can supply our needs. They're false prophets, false prosperity teaching. And I mean, they had a list of 35 pastors up there, and we're condemning them all. Well, that doesn't sound like God? The Bible says if you find a brother in fault, to restore him in the spirit of meekness, not to just blast him. Have you ever tried to call him and talk to him? Have you ever listened to what they said? Chances are they didn't, because I was in their shoes. I was against all these people. I would have been the first one putting that picture up on the internet, calling them a cult, and never listened to a word they said, only what somebody told me they said, which was completely wrong, or twisted, not completely wrong. It was twisted. It was half the truth. Because they said the words, but they didn't give the explanation. So we go on from there. Verse 19. But God's truth stands firm like a foundation stone with this inscription: the Lord knows who are His, and all who belong to the Lord must turn away from evil. You know how many people hear this, read this? All who belong to the Lord, He will keep them from evil. He won't let them do evil. It says, no, all those who belong to the Lord must turn away from evil. Who is the subject there of the must? It's us. We must turn away. We have an act of choice, of free will, to say yes or no to evil. And He's telling you to turn away from it. Verse 20. In a wealthy home, some utensils are made of gold and silver, and some are made of wood and clay. The expensive utensils are used for special occasions, and the cheap ones are for everyday use. People stop there. And this is why I say, why I teach so much, because I'll hear people say or imply, I'm just a broken vessel. They talk about their weaknesses, thinking they're being humble and repentant. I'm just a broken vessel. I'm nothing but a worm. God is good. I'm nothing compared to God. No, He created you in His image and in His likeness. He gave you the coat of righteousness. He took the coat of righteousness that Jesus wore, which couldn't be any more righteous, took it off Jesus and put it on you. So for you to say you're just a worm is an insult to that coat that you're wearing, that you've got put on you on the new birth. And thinking about, the Bible says, what you think on, you'll gravitate towards. So if I think about the worm that I am and the mistakes I made, guess what? I'm still focused on them. That's where I'm going to gravitate towards. But if I start considering this new coat that I have of righteousness, if I start considering He who lives in me is greater than the world, and I start considering the strength He gave me, that I have the power to overcome any temptation that comes because I have Him, if I start thinking on these things, I'll gravitate towards victory. Next verse. If you didn't stop there, I don't even have to say who's implied, because it says it. If you keep yourself pure. Is God going to do this for you? He's going to convict you. He's going to have people come up to you and challenge you. When you read the Word of God, you're going to read the mirror of the Word. This is what I look like, and this is what I should look like. He'll lead you to those scriptures. He'll make you feel miserable every time you go the wrong way. He's never going to make you. If you keep yourself pure, what will happen then if you keep yourself pure? You will be a special utensil. I'm just an old clay pot, broken pot. I'll just sit in the back. No. You have the choice to determine what utensil you're going to be in this house. He said, if you keep yourself pure, you will be a special utensil for honorable use. I've said this so many times, especially being in the construction field. Guys have their favorite tools, their favorite hammers, favorite knife, their favorite saw, and I have favorite brushes. We went through that. You want to be honorable use. You want, when somebody's hurting, for God to say, son, go to, because He knows that you're going to represent Him well. You're not going to be judgmental. When people come to you for help, they're going to get the same help that you got when you went to Him. He's not going to say, I can't believe you did this. You're going to give the same love and forgiveness that you received. do as Christians. So you want to be that honorable person. And guys, sometimes it ain't easy. And that doesn't mean that the person that did something to you, it's okay that they did it, it was wrong. It doesn't mean that it doesn't hurt you. It doesn't mean that you're going to let them to continue to do it. If they were going to continue to do it, I would fight them if I had to. And I'd still be walking in love. And I could still forgive them. You're not a doormat. It doesn't mean you should be treated wrong. If you keep yourself pure, you will be a special vessel for honorable use. Your life will be clean, and you will be ready for the master's use for every good work. I mean, that's my desire. God, use me. Use me. I want to be prepared so he can use me. Verse 22, we'll start winding down here. Run from. Again, I can go through scriptures all day long. Does this sound like God's going to make me do this? There's nothing in the language and the verbiage and the terminology of the word that says anything about God going to make you do these things. Run from anything that stimulates your youthful lusts. Do you realize one person, I told you this before, I worked for a cleaning company, I cleaned the bar. Cleaned that bar for a couple of years. Never even noticed the liquor bottles on the shelf. Never even noticed them. Somebody else, if they walked in that bar, might be tempted and shouldn't be in that bar. So can we make a list of you should do this, you can't? No, no, each person is different. But if anything stimulates the lust of the flesh, you need to avoid it. No, no, no. Run from it. Isn't that what Joseph did? He ran from it. You know, we apply the grace and forgiveness to God way too easily. I'll 1 John 1:9. I'll ask God to forgive me. He's faithful and just to forgive me. He'll just forgive me. And it's funny how the people who will receive forgiveness from God, all right, I'm just human, I make mistakes. They don't forgive other people like that. They hold people to a really high standard. If they do something against them, oh, I can't believe you did that. That bothers me. Run from anything that stimulates youthful lust. Okay, instead, we're talking about studying the word, right? Every word means something. Don't just read the word, study it. It told you to run from this, and instead of doing this, it's going to tell you to do something else. So running from sin is not enough. Just running from youthful lust, if that's your life, you're never going to be free from it. Because if you run this way, it's going to be over there. So you can't just be on the run from temptation. It says, instead. Instead, pursue righteousness. I thought we were righteousness. I am the righteousness of God. Well, as far as God sees me, but there's the experiential side that we have to live out. And he tells me to pursue righteousness, go after it, run after it. So when I turn my back on these temptations and the lust and this ungodliness, if I'm not pursuing godliness in God, I'll eventually wind up back there. Pursue righteousness. Pursue righteous living, faithfulness, love, and peace. Enjoy the companionship of those who call on the Lord with pure hearts. We kind of get back to people going to church and how often they go to church. This tells me to enjoy the companionship of those who call on the Lord with pure hearts. You know, this is something you get from church you can't get online. God cannot inspire that pastor to give you a fresh word because it's pre-recorded. You know, this morning as we were praying, I felt inspired to pray for people that needed a touch. You can't get that online. And occasionally, God will lay something on my heart, whether I do it during preaching or right after I'm done preaching. I'll go up and talk to them. And even better yet, we're all the body, not just me. The body's supposed to minister to one another. So that's a critical thing you miss when you think I'm staying home and watching church. You can't get helped by your TV. Your TV's not going to give you an encouraging word to say, brother, I'm here for you. You need help, I'll be there. It's not going to happen. These are the things that we're supposed to do as a body for each other. When we come together, we're supposed to be praying and hearing from God, and God's going to put a word on our heart. We're supposed to come ready to help somebody else. That can't happen at home by yourself. And let me just say one more thing about attending church. A lot of times, the truth that you need, he said, if you continue in my truth, then you'll know the truth, and then the truth will set you free. A lot of times, the truth that you need for this situation today will have been put in you over a series of teachings. A word here, a word here, a word here. So when you start missing things, and I'm not glorifying myself, but the Word of God does say I'm a gift. Thinks he's the gift of me. Yeah, I am. And if you would see it that way, you'd get more. If you come here expecting to pull on the gift, not on me, there's an office I'm stepping in that I live in that you could pull on and get something out of in spite of me. Can't get that from TV. You have to have a pick. He's my pastor. Can't get that. You have to be here. I think I want to remember where I am. Verse 23. We'll pick up there next time. Okay. Who's going to remind me where I left off? Verse 23. Okay. Amen. Let's stand. We'll close in prayer. Guys, I know how busy this world is. I really do. Probably more than you realize. You know, having a family, being a pastor, working a job, trying to juggle everything. Doing weddings and everything else that I do, the wedding, both weekends. Just the bombardment of decisions I have to make, questions that people ask me. If you don't learn how to take that stuff to God, it's just going to wear you out. It'll wear you out. You have to be making time for God in your life. And I'm not just talking about the checklist, yeah, okay, I read my Bible. I'm talking about, it may not happen every day, but you can't let too much time go before you have that connection with God. I cry. I don't know what you do. Surprised, huh? When the presence of God starts to fill where I am, you need it. You can't go without it. Don't just keep running, running, running. You know, I read three chapters, I checked. No, 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 no. I mean, sometimes you have to just shut everything down. Shut everything off. The phone, your life. I told you a story. I did that once when I locked myself in the closet. My brother-in-law came, not Bucky, my other one, back then, when he came looking for me because he had to talk to me. And it was really like a one-bedroom apartment. He was the landlord, and she's like, is Jack here? And she's like, yeah. Can I talk to him? I could go get him. So he opened the door to the closet to go get somebody. World don't understand that. Bible says, go in your closet, pray. So I'm going to do it because I need to hear from God. You have to have those moments. You have to. I enjoy those moments. I'm addicted. I'm addicted to Jesus. Amen. If you're here today,